Rattlesnake has been captured at a landowner's property about 20 miles from here, and they don't want it on their property, and they want it moved off into the forest a distance away. And I don't usually move rattlesnakes, but in this situation it needs to be moved because there are dogs, small children, people walking around in gardens. It could end up ending pretty badly for someone or an animal. So I'm going to move the snake. But there's a dilemma, and this is an exciting dilemma as far as I'm concerned. It's sort of a challenge, and that challenge is, can I get there? Can I safely get the snake? Yes, I don't have any doubt about that, but then can I return home? As you may or may not know, I drive an all-electric Nissan Leaf, and this car has no gas engine. It is only electric, and it is charging now. As you can see, it's plugged in to what will be a chicken coop one day here at work. It is charging level one. Level one means simply that it's trickle charging the battery. The car has a large lithium ion battery under the four seats. So it's been trickle charging now since about 1 o'clock when I found out about the snake situation. But as you can see from the blinking lights on the dashboard, it's not full yet. That's right, the battery's not full. It's pretty close, but close may not be enough in this instance. I've owned this car for 2 years now, a little over 2 years, driven it 30,000 miles, and never once have I had a range anxiety issue where I really didn't know if I was going to make it to and from my destination without running out of juice. This might be the day. So, there's nothing I can do about it. I don't have another option because my gas-powered vehicle, which I would normally take in this type of situation, is out of the state with my wife right now. So my only option is my Leaf. And of course, luck. And of course, also driving very carefully so that I don't use too much power. Some of you out there might be like, why in the world did you even get an electric vehicle? That's ridiculous. Range anxiety, I couldn't handle that. Well, I look at it as a challenge, for one thing, but bigger than that is what the car represents. This car runs on electricity that you can generate at home. You can plug this car into solar panels and make your own fuel on your property. That is super cool as far as I'm concerned, and I'm working to do just that here at this location. One day, this car will be fully solar powered and will not put out any emissions at all. I mean, the car itself doesn't put out any emissions at all now, but since it's being charged on coal fired energy and hydropower and a mix, you know, it's a mix in the grid, coal, hydro, wind, nuclear, even some landfill gas thrown in there. Well, the car is, you know, not 100% clean burning, but it's cleaner than any car that runs on gas. If you don't believe me, take a look at these links. Okay, anyway, the science proves the car is cleaner than anything that runs on gas, but the whole problem I'm having here now is, am I going to get to the snake and then get home safely? And that's the challenge. So, I'm going to unplug the car now, because it's time to go. I'm going to take the charging cable with me just in case. Because you just never know what may happen out there on the road. So here we go. All right, so here's the verdict. Let's see how much power we have. The car's been charging since 2 o'clock. We have 57 miles of range. Is that gonna be enough? Well, it'll definitely get me to the destination, but will it get me home? That's the question. Good thing is, not too far from the destination, I have a friend who will let me stay at their house if something happens, like say I need to go and charge the car, you know, overnight because I'm too low. And the sad thing is the county that I'm going to, which is actually next door to the county I'm in now, doesn't have a single level 2 charging station yet. Transylvania County, I'm talking about you. But hopefully this week or next week, they're going to be putting in the first 2 level 2 charging stations. Now, what's a level 2? That's a charging station that will charge this car in about an hour and a half. Okay, it's 240 volts, maybe 2 hours. Depends on how low your charge is. It will charge the car much more rapidly than level 1, which is what I just unplugged, which is a trickle charger. So, that being said, I need to write down my mileage. I keep detailed records. Scientist in me, I guess. It also helps me learn the car better. So let's see, we have 52 in eco mode and 57 in 52 in normal drive mode and 57 in eco mode. Okay, so it's time to go. Here we go. It's going to be an interesting evening, I believe. But, you know, I don't want to leave that rattlesnake under that container. The landowner trapped the rattlesnake under a potted plant, like a wooden planter of some design, according to him. And the snake's been under there for a couple of hours, so don't want to leave it there any longer than need be. And so that's where I'm going now. So follow along in my adventure. That's what this is. It's going to be an adventure, I can already tell. See you guys tomorrow.
See you tomorrow, Steve.
Take care. Destination into my GPS, and it says that it is 37 miles from my current location. That's doable.
Left turn ahead onto road.
Thank you, Nissan Leaf. Now that's doable, but the thing that concerns me is the fact that I'm going to be gaining a lot of elevation and going around 60 miles an hour for quite a distance. So those two things really eat up the range in an electric vehicle. I mean, you know, it's not as noticeable, but the same thing happens in a gas-powered vehicle. When you go uphill and when you go at a high rate of speed, you burn a lot more gas. But in an electric car, you really notice it because, well, in this electric car, in the Nissan Leaf, you really notice it simply because its battery pack is small compared to, you know, the size of the car. It doesn't hold as much energy as a gas tank would if it was the same size. So, you know, it's one of those things you just have to settle for when you buy an electric car, such as the Nissan Leaf, BMW i3, or any of the others that are totally electric.
About a quarter of a mile, right turn at the end of the road onto the road.
Well, she's right so far. But now if you buy a Tesla, of course, big difference. You're paying a lot more, but you're also getting a car with a lot more range. So that lessens the range anxiety to a great degree.
Right turn at the end of the road onto the road.
All right, Electra, I know where I am, but I did decide to put in the GPS just to help me out. However, one really nice thing about driving an electric vehicle is that right now, as I'm rolling down the mountain, the car is making some of its own fuel for this journey. Right now, we have 74 miles of range built up from, let's see, what did we start with? 57. So we went from 57 to now 73. So the car is really putting on a lot of miles as it rolls down the hill. That's called regenerative braking. And
about
the whole,
a quarter of a mile, left turn at the end of the road onto road.
The whole principle of it is basically when you're not using the electric motor, it is becoming a generator.
Left turn at the end of the road onto.
It becomes a generator and therefore puts power back into your battery. There is not a gas vehicle alive that makes its own fuel. All electric cars make their own fuel. Need to write something down. So, let's see. Okay. 57. Wow. I think that's the most I've ever regenerated rolling down that mountain. I just regenerated 19 miles of range, and I'm really gonna need that. So now I have, from this point on, 76 miles of range remaining. If I can get out into traffic. Very busy right now because it is rush hour, even though I'm out in the woods. Lots of traffic. Here we go. 76 miles. Oh, it just went up to 77 just for a moment. Now it's back down to 76. So 76 miles of range. Can we rescue this rattlesnake and then get home with that amount of range? I don't know. It might be possible. No, that's okay. I'll have a, I don't know which one it is, but is there like a chicken bacon Swiss or something like that?
The Asiago Ranch Chicken Bacon Club?
Yeah, that'll work.
Alright, did you want the combo or just a sandwich?
A sandwich and a small fries, and that'll be fine. I don't need any drink, I have water.
Alright, and for your sandwich, did you want that spicy homestyle or grilled?
Grilled.
And you said a small fry?
Yeah, that'd be fine.
Alright, anything else?
That'll do it.
713, thank you.
Thank you. Wow, $7.13 for that? I'm astonished. I don't eat at fast food very often. This is probably one of the first times I've eaten at Wendy's in I don't know how long. But $7.13 for a chicken sandwich and a small fry. I could power my car for an entire week on that amount of money. Wow. Okay, well, this better be good. We'll see, I suppose.
$7.13,
sir.
There you go, sir.
Thank you. Take care. Alright, let's see if this sandwich is any good. Let's see if I can still eat and drive. I mean, like I said, the sun's going down. It is 6:30. I have 25 miles of distance to cover and 62 miles of range. The car will make it. I think I will make it now that I have food, thanks to Wendy. Oh boy, I hope this thing doesn't drip all over me, but here we go. Okay. Very salty. Yeah, very salty. It's good if you like a lot of salt. I had to eat something though. Didn't have time to go home. Really didn't want to be dealing with a rattlesnake in the dark. All right. Here we go. I have 14 miles to go. I'm down to 38 miles of range, and I'm climbing another mountain at 55 miles an hour. Okay, I'm up on the plateau now, on the ridge top. I'm running a ridge now. 29 miles of range remaining. I have no doubt that I will make it to my destination. Oh, now this is some interesting little tidbit here. Remember earlier when I regenerated 19 miles of range? Well, if I had not have regenerated that 19 miles of range, okay, I would be, well, I have 30 now, so I would be around 12 miles, 10 or 11, 12 miles of range right now. Yeah, scary thought. That would put me probably just barely reaching my destination, since I have 12 miles to get there, according to the GPS. And it's getting dark. But hey, it's part of the fun, right? Hey, check this out. I'm passing gas. I had to say that. I just passed a gas station. That's right. I know, corny joke. But I like to make the corny jokes because, you know what? Despite the limiting factor of the range on this car, I never buy gas for this car. I never put fuel in it other than plugging it into the wall, and that's just brilliant. You know, it costs me about an average of $1 a day to fuel this car. $7 a week. You know, that's incredible. And back when I used to have, we used to have two gas vehicles, our gas bills were insane. Even now with the fuel prices lower, it's still cheaper than driving on gas. You know, you got to take into account, it's not just the gas, it's the oil and all the maintenance, the tune-ups, you know, exhaust pipes, mufflers, catalytic converters, belts, hoses, points, condenser, if your car's that old, if you remember what those are, spark plugs, glow plugs, fuel filters, air filters, transmission filters, clutches, all that stuff gone. This car doesn't have any of that. So it's an absolutely brilliant way to drive. It's freedom. That's what it is. It really is freedom. You know, when you buy a gas-powered vehicle, it's like a subscription to dependency, really. It's almost like a drug, because when you buy the car, you have to buy all those other things. When you buy an electric car, you buy an electric car. You plug it into the wall, and you pay a little bit more on your power bill. You know, we don't really notice it on our power bill. That's the nice thing, is because we, at about the same time we got the car, we started to replace all of our incandescent light bulbs with compact fluorescents. And now we're going to LEDs slowly. We're transitioning all the way to LEDs. So the money that that saves us is about how much it costs to power the car. So it really, we can't even notice any increase in our electric bill. Just a tiny bit at first, but now we don't even see it. And once I get my solar charging station built, which is what I'm working on, the car will be free to drive. Right now we're going to rescue a rattlesnake. And we're almost there. We're 3.7 miles from the destination. We have 24 miles of range, and we're going up another hill. So here we go. It says I'm 1.4 miles from the next turn. I'm down to 19 miles of range. It says 1 mile. 16 miles of range.
Entering the road with incomplete map data. The route will be shown in a different color in this area. Please follow traffic regulations.
Interesting.
The route to your destination includes roads through incomplete map areas. Voice guidance will not be provided in these areas. Entering the road with incomplete map data. The route will be shown in a different color in this area. Please follow traffic regulations.
I think this is my road. Yeah, this is it. All right, 16 miles of range. We're finally down to the small roads that lead us to the house. The small roads, did I say that? The secondary roads. Small little road. Well, it's no wonder they have a rattlesnake. They live out in the middle of nowhere. It's beautiful, I'll tell you that. Okay, so I'm at the house and my range is down to 12 miles, so we're gonna have to plug in. All right, guys.
And this is Patrick.
Hey. Howdy.
He's the snake handler around here.
All right, well, let me get the cord and I'll plug it in. Oops. This comes with a car.
Oh, you didn't need such a long thing here then. Okay.
Nah.
Wait, well, you're right here. So
and just plug this in.
Okey-doke.
So
well, you
simple.
Don't need the...
Oh, what is that?
And then this. All plug right. This into here.
Yeah, I saw this on the Earthshine website.
Good.
Oh, yeah. On the Earthshine Nature Programs site?
Yeah, that there were the electric cars and stuff. So.
Yeah, I do a little bit of everything. If it comes to animals, nature, environment, science, and of course, electric vehicles and renewable energy, because if we don't take care of the Earth, then we don't have all these beautiful things we care about so much.
Okay.
You know?
Okay.
So there you go.
So this is a 165-acre conservation easement with Carolina Mountains.
Land Conservancy?
Land Conservancy.
Yeah,
They're
great folks. So all the land that you're a part of here?
Own the watershed here, and
wow.
It's pretty special. So we grow for pollinators.
Excellent.
We grow a lot of organic food, mostly all of our fruits and vegetables. So it's a pretty clean environment.
Oh, that's great.
So anyway, saw the snake about a week ago.
Okay.
But then this morning we were up working, and Patrick said, "Oop, there he is." And he was close into the garden area.
Mm.
And then he moved into the garden area. I came out and got the dogs down, but right where I had been harvesting celerac, he was right there. And this is what really got Patrick's attention, because he said, "Well, come look, here he is." And I said, "Where?" Couldn't even see him.
Ooh.
He was so camouflaged in the mulch amongst the vegetation. So that got our attention, because it's like, ooh.
We had our hands in there just about 2 hours before. So.
Well, he's definitely a nuisance snake then, and you know, and he's one that could accidentally bite you. You know, he would it out of defense, but
we appreciate that.
Yeah, and you know, I mean, you know what he does for the environment, of course, but because of his toxin, you know, it could be hazardous to you guys and your dogs.
And cats.
Well, let me get my tools. It is getting dark,
okay,
so let me get my tools. This should be pretty quick, though.
Okay, good.
I even let the bad apples be here for
the wildlife. I see the little gnaw marks. Squirrels have been.
Yeah.
Now, this, of course, is one thing that will attract rattlesnakes, because this attracts the rodents.
Sure. Exactly.
But it's all part of the ecosystem.
Well, yeah, I mean, we don't mind the rattlesnakes doing their thing.
Right, right.
We've
had them around before, and we've not really had problems. We had we've had several snake bites, probably from copperheads.
Probably,
We never saw them.
Right. They're much more common.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wouldn't want to get moved into plastic either.
Well, are these heirloom apples you have going here?
Yeah, that's an old heirloom called Yates.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah, the wind really brought them down, so we're...
Oh, I bet.
There's two of them that were planted here back probably late 19th century. Or
right. No, I wouldn't doubt it. And, you know, taking a look at this, you have a rattlesnake right beside an apple tree where there's apples that have been gnawed on the ground by rodents. It's
right.
So, like, perfect. It's
oh,
just...
it is. I mean, we have some video a couple of years ago.
Mm-hmm.
All of these things were out. We had... We would have... like bears,
right.
Coyotes.
Oh well.
You know, bears. We have a game camera. We
right.
get 100 shots a night.
Oh, that's amazing.
Of just things coming in to eat the apples.
Oh wow.
Coyotes love apples for
oh,
some reason.
Oh, totally.
Okay, so what's your plan here?
Okay, well, if you want to take the well, I can do it. I mean,
oh yeah.
Oh, you got water in there? Okay. And the sandbags, I mean, let's
you
as we
just open the thing so it'll come out.
Well, he'll be in there when if you lift that up, or well, I tell you what, let's see, is it plastic? Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'll use the hook and I'm gonna lift it up. I'm gonna pull it, I'm gonna push it actually this way.
Okay.
Good. Hopefully he's real cool right now.
Yeah.
I'm just gonna tip it that way.
Alrighty.
And hopefully I'll be able to pick him up on the hook and set him in here, and
okay.
then I'm going to take the top
okay.
and set it on there.
Okay.
Patrick, why don't you just step back a little bit? You spent enough time with this guy today.
I had my dance.
So.
But I followed your advice and, you know, basically got him to coil.
Right, right.
And then I could
just put it over him.
Right on him.
That's the way I've always worked it. Woo! Now I just scared him. He's there. Oh, there we go. No. Okay, that's good. Good, good, good. We got it. We're good. All right, now I want to try to get a picture of him as he's sitting there because he's a little disoriented now after I lifted the thing up. Hopefully I'll have a few seconds before he decides to try to move.
Because I have a zoom, I'm
okay.
fine.
Okay.
I think
he's considered a tiny head then, huh?
It's kind of small, but his body's pretty big. I think he's got a rodent in his belly.
Okay.
I can't talk. Okay, here
Patrick
we go.
Saw him.
Oh wow. Amazing.
Ooh, I smell him.
Yeah, he's musking.
Well,
no head. Got him.
All right.
That's all there is to it.
Good deal.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you guys think it's funny, don't you? You got a girl out.
Oh, they're laughing at us.
One of the hens out.
Crazy. I'm going to grab an apple. I need a snack after doing that.
Okay. Well, help yourself. Try one of these.
So the car's been charging for a couple of hours now, and I have 26 miles of range, and I'm ready to go. Got the rattlesnake, and yeah, so very successful.
Have rattlesnake will travel,
and a very successful afternoon and evening. Nice hanging out with you guys.
Yeah, thanks very much. Yeah. We really appreciate it.
Yeah, and
we'll stay in touch, and
yeah,
you'll
definitely.
See Patrick with some hemlock education and beetle
exactly.
releases.
Yeah. yeah. Take care.
Bye.
Yep, 26 miles in drive and 29 in eco. Well, that was an exciting evening, meeting some really cool people who are doing great things with land preservation and working to spread the love of the sassy beetle, who is of course a natural predator on the hemlock woolly adelgid. And so these folks are doing some great things to preserve nature and wildlife, which is basically exactly what I'm trying to do as well. And it's really cool that we have somehow been brought together by a rattlesnake. Who knows what the future holds, right? It holds great things if you let it, if you accept those great things and turn them into great possibilities. Now, hopefully the great possibility of the Horans letting me charge my car at their house will get me home without any incident. So the story isn't over yet. We still have about 30 miles of travel ahead of us. Here we go. So I'm rolling down a really nice long hill, regenerating almost 15 kilowatts of electricity, already up to 32 miles of range. Let's see how much I can pull off by the time I get to the bottom of this hill. Look at that, almost full regen. Wow. Gotta love a vehicle that makes some of its own fuel. Copperhead crossing the road back here. Just saw him. There he is. Get this guy out of the road. Check him out. Oh, that's a rattler. That's a young rattlesnake. See the rattle? All right, come on, buddy. Let's go. Plopping him down there. See you later. If I didn't get him off the road, he would have surely been dead out here in the middle of nowhere. He is really young. Look at the taper on that rattle. See you later, guy. I don't know how he survived that dump truck I just passed. Gosh, it was crazy. Boy, that was fun. Two rattlesnakes rescued in the same evening. Awesome. This gives me great pleasure, I'll tell you that. Wow. That was really cool. Well, I reached the bottom of the mountain and I have 27 miles of range remaining. Heading up now, a couple of climbs here, and then highway speeds again, 60 miles an hour. But I'm only 13 miles from home, so I believe I'm gonna be able to pull this off. I'm home and I have 10 miles of range. So the trip was a success. It was definitely an adventure. I rescued two rattlesnakes and met some really amazing people, saw some beautiful country, and yes, it was, as I said, definitely an adventure. The leaf performed admirably.
Of course, I would have run out of charge if it was not for the Horans letting me charge the vehicle at their house. So I gratefully thank you for that. Thank you so much. But now I'm at my destination, and that is that. Let's juice up the leaf.